Hi, I'm Earl Butch Graves, Jr., CEO of Black Enterprise. Thanks for joining me for this week's all-new episode of From the Corner Office. For the past decade, we have witnessed dynamic shifts in global business. Most recently, it has been marked by crises and uncertainty due to the public health and economic devastation of the COVID-19 pandemic and worldwide focus on racial inequality that have significantly altered the corporate landscape. My guest today is a chief executive adept at leading a multinational corporation through these complex and chaotic times. Roy Gori serves as the president and CEO of Manulife, Canada's largest insurance company and one of the largest asset management firms in the world. With headquarters in Toronto, Manulife has more than 37,000 employees, 115,000 agents, and thousands of distribution partners, meeting the needs of more than 30 million customers worldwide. Moreover, he runs a massive operation with more than $1.3 trillion in assets under management, with offices in Canada, Asia, Europe, and United States as John Hancock. An Australian native, Roy, who holds a Bachelor of Economics and Finance degree from the University of New South Wales and an MBA from the University of Technology, Sydney, started his career at Citibank in 1989, where among other senior roles, he was responsible for the institution's Asia Pacific retail business, which included insurance and wealth management. He joined Manulife as president and CEO for Asia in 2015, with oversight of operations in 12 markets across the continent, driving the financial services giant's rapid business growth in the region. And by 2017, he was appointed CEO of Manulife. His leadership has been marked by a sharp focus on the enhancement of customer service and the integration of digital innovation aligned with the corporate mission of making decisions easier and lives better. As a champion of corporate diversity, equity, and inclusion, Roy chairs Manulife's DEI Council and has been instrumental in the development of a new strategy and investments within that area. He is also a passionate advocate for health and wellness, promoting behavioral insurance through award-winning products like Manulife Vitality and Manulife Move. Roy, it is my pleasure. Thank you for joining me today.
Well, thank you, Butch. It's a pleasure to be here as well.
Absolutely. So, Roy, we in 2021 now, we've had a change of administrations here in the U.S., but this past year, 2020, has been a year unlike any year that I can recall in my, I'll call it, very brief life. And that is dealing with both the pandemic of COVID-19 and its disruption on business. And I'll come back to the pandemic of racism and how that has impacted. But would love to get your perspective on the pandemic of COVID-19. What has been the impact on your business, both in Canada as well in the US, and to the degree that there have been differences, which I assume there probably have been, and what specifically you have done towards trying to combat it and continue to move the company forward?
Well, thanks, Butch, and you're absolutely right. 2020 will certainly go down as an unprecedented year for so many reasons. And you know, as I reflect back on the year that we just had, I think it was a year of huge awakening. We're going to talk about, you know, the issue of systemic inequality and racism, I'm sure, later. But as far as the virus is concerned, it really, I think, brought to the fore a realization that we're incredibly fragile as a society as it relates to going about doing our everyday business. And so I think that's really helped people appreciate the need for stability, confidence, and systems that help people continue to live their lives. When I think about COVID, the impact to our organization has been very significant. We're an organization that operates globally across three broad geographies, Canada, the US, and Asia. And we have more than 30 million customers, and almost a third of those comes from each of those three geographies, a third in Asia, a third in Canada, and a third in the US. So for us, navigating this challenge was one that was very complicated because we had the geographical challenges of being in different parts of the world at different points in time. But at the same time, that also presented an opportunity because we were able to see different marketplaces, different countries navigate the challenges in a very different way. And as a result, we got a bit of a glimpse into it early, especially given our presence in Asia and in China, as to what was unfolding. And that helped us, I guess, get on very quickly in North America to the need to prepare in advance of the virus really coming to our part of the world. But it's obviously had a huge impact on society and on organizations and on individuals. And the human tragedy of the situation is certainly something that we should never, ever forget. Our role as an insurance company really came to the fore. I think one thing that we're very proud of is that we're a company that supports people through crises like this. And we've actually paid out claims to many hundreds of thousands of customers in excess of $390 million actually for families of customers who've succumbed to COVID. So that's a huge tragedy, and it's terrible that this has happened. But in some way, we've been somewhat helpful to customers and families of customers that have had to navigate this incredibly difficult time and this incredibly difficult period. I think Sure. The other thing for us is that it's obviously brought to the fore the need to digitize our business. I think the fact that we couldn't interact with customers and our advisors or our distribution agents in a face-to-face way meant that the journey and the agenda of digitizing our business was something that we were very passionate about and we put a lot of progress against. But in 2020, I think that really came to the fore and was something that we really, I think, took to a whole new level.
No question. I would love to know a little bit about in regards to, the U.S. has obviously had a tragic impact of the death toll and the positivity rate in the U.S. has been dramatic. Not that it hasn't been, a tragedy for those in Asia or those in Canada, but it's Canada specifically because it's connected to the U.S. It's in North America. What do you see as the primary differences in how Canada handled this pandemic versus how the U.S. handled the pandemic? Because you had employees in both places, you have customers in both places. What worked better, if you will, I hate to say better, in this kind of environment, but more effectively perhaps in Canada and how the country responded to this pandemic versus what the U.S. did, in your opinion?
Well, I think there's a lot of similarities, to be frank, not just between Canada and the US in terms of navigating the pandemic. But if I look at our global operation, it has also given me the opportunity to see which markets perhaps navigated the crisis better. And we certainly, I think, have a lot to learn. I think we have a lot to learn from seeing the different countries and the different marketplaces actually navigate the difficulties of COVID. And in particular, I think Asia, actually most countries and many countries in Asia did a better job of navigating the crisis in 2020. I think 21 brings a whole lot of different challenges to the fore, and we can talk about that. But for 2020, I think the path to really reduce the impact of the spread of the disease was a function of early masking. Really everyone aligning to the idea that masks were a very effective tool to help contain the spread of the disease. That was certainly a very big part of the agenda. I think lockdown restrictions that went in place very quickly without much discussion or deliberation was another key vehicle through which navigating the crisis was very helpful. I think contact tracing, again, the countries that did well did contact tracing typically very well. They were able to identify who was infected and who was in their immediate vicinity for the preceding 2, 3, 4, 5 days. And as a result, to reach out to those individuals to ensure that they were either getting tested or quarantining basically helped prevent the spread of asymptomatic individuals. And then I would say, over and above that, I think the testing itself, having a robust testing mechanism where if folks wanted a test, if there was any doubt or concern as to whether they were infected, that they could actually get a test and therefore as a result of that, quickly quarantine themselves, was another key vehicle. So I would argue that for 2020, the countries that did those things really well were able to open up their economy and maybe in some cases get back to a more freer flow of engaging than those that maybe didn't do those that quickly.
Now, you talked a little bit about the acceleration of digitization, moving to a digital world, which we had to, all businesses have really had to. In some ways, perhaps, if there was anything good that came out of this pandemic, it has been forcing business to move into what my four millennial children would call the real world, right? In their minds, everything should be off of their phone, everything should be digitized and what have you. But it really has forced business to rethink how they do business. For Manulife, how is it that as people are beginning this process of finding vaccination and having it accessible to them, how are you guys handling in regards to employees returning back to work? What percentage of employees are coming back to work? Are they being required to have to take the vaccine? How is it you guys see this unfolding over the next 6 months?
Yeah, that's a great question. And you're absolutely right. I think the rate and scale of digitization that we saw across most organizations, not just ours and not just our industry, was very significant. And I often have said to people that we've achieved more from a digitization perspective in the 10 months of 2020 than we had in the previous 10 years. And as an organization, we'd been investing in digital tools and enhancing our capabilities. We'd spent more than $650 million, in fact, in the 3 years prior to 2020 to really up our game and up our capability on the digital front. And thankfully, we had made those investments because it really put us in good stead. But the biggest obstacle that prevents organizations like ours, large organizations, from embracing a digital agenda is that there is inertia to keep doing things the way they've always been done. And that's true for your employees. In our case, 37,000 of them, 115,000 agents. But it's also true for customers. The comfort of this is the way we've always done things is something that really prevents change. Right. And that is the biggest obstacle. But in 2020, when you didn't have the option of sending a fax in or sending a letter in because no one was there to accept it, you had to accept other ways. And digital tools are clearly, which were clearly available, were much simpler, easier, and quite frankly, in many instances, the only option that was available to customers and for employees. So I think that circuit breaker from the inertia of doing things the way they've always been done really, I think, created this embracement of digital tools and technologies. And I think that really was a huge step change that we were able to experience. The challenge for us and for other organizations is to not let any normalization of the current situation lead to people going back to the way they used to operate before COVID. So we've got to not only step up our game on the digital front, but make sure that we continue to drive that change agenda. And I think that's true, as I said, for digital, but I think the inertia and the challenge that comes with embracing change is something that affects so many different parts of corporations and quite frankly, society.
So where are you all at the particular moment? Are you back at 20%, 50%? Must people take the vaccine? How is it that you are handling it, whether in Canada or handling it in the US?
Yeah, so in the middle of March of last year, we pretty much declared everyone who could work from home. And thankfully, we'd invested in the technology to facilitate and allow that. But we got to a peak of 95% of our people working from home. And to be honest, in North America, the US and Canada, there is still more than 95% of our people currently working from home, working remotely. In Asia, we've seen that percentage change and move. So in some markets, we've got nearly 90% of the people back in the office. In for example, in China and even in Hong Kong, Vietnam, we have nearly a full contingent of people back to a work from the office environment as they were perhaps working before. Other countries in Asia are at different points in the cycle. Indonesia and the Philippines, for example, are still grappling with the spread of the virus and containing the virus. And as a result, more than 90% of our people in those markets are still working from home. So if I look at Asia overall, it would be roughly 50% of our people working from home, 50% in the office. In North America, US and Canada, it would be 95%. In terms of my expectation of how soon we'll get back to the office or some similar construct, to be frank, I am not seeing that that's going to happen at scale in North America in 2020. We've said and we declared very early on that we'd put the health and safety of our people as our number one priority, and we would not rush people back if it wasn't safe to do so. And to be frank, until we can get to a point of herd immunity that allows people to safely get back into the office environment, we're not going to rush people back. So to be frank, at the earliest, I think it might be September, October, but I would not be surprised if it doesn't happen at all this year and that it's more likely into the early part of 2022.
Yes, that has been what we have been thinking it's going to be. I think that, everyone originally was like, oh, a couple of months, by the summertime, it'll go away. Obviously, that didn't happen. We've seen it where people have had to postpone weddings, postpone big events, graduations, any number of different things. But the truth of the matter is that the health and safety of your employees has to be first. And we've been out since March the 11th ourselves. We're coming up on what has been 1 year, and we've become very accustomed to it. It's going to be interesting as people become comfortable. What will be the environment going back into work in New York? I mean, you all probably have a huge investment in real estate, I would assume, across the world. And then you look up and you say, now, do we really need everybody sitting in their office or cubicle every single day, 5 days a week? Is that really an efficient way for us to operate? And I suspect a lot of organizations will have to go through that same calculus to figure out what makes the most sense.
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right. And I do think that the new norm will be a combination of people using the office, but at the same time, enjoying the benefits of work from home and the flexibility that comes from that. I think that's going to be a new tool that is in the toolkit of corporations. And I think that's going to benefit, individuals and certainly many employees in a very significant way. I still think, though, that there will be a place for an office. People often ask me whether the office is dead, and I don't think so. I think that having a meeting place where people come together and collide and create and innovate is still valuable, but you're absolutely right. I think it's going to have to be a dynamic construct of what that office of the future actually looks like, and it will be one that I think incorporates some of the flexibility that we've been able to see worked well in the current environment.
Absolutely. So let me pivot to the other pandemic that the United States has been grappling with over the past year. Well, has been grappling with, I'd say, for 400 years, but in the past year in particular has been, it's brought a lot more attention to, and that's the sort of the pandemic of systemic racism that has existed in the US. I can't compare it to Asia as much as you, if you will, as I would perhaps Canada. But the US obviously has seen a huge, or has been experiencing a huge problem in what has been, frankly, the treatment, the promotion, the advancement of African Americans, both in corporate America, in society at large, in jobs, in housing. It's across the board, much less the graphic impact we've seen of what has been police brutality. And that has had a really big impact on how corporations are beginning to look at what role they can play. What can they do? What can corporate America do to help to combat this? Your business is a global business, and so racism on one thing in one place is not exactly the same thing in another place. But you obviously have a, you know, you have a strong presence in the U.S. and would like to get, you know, you guys have, like a number of corporations are pushing efforts in diversity, equity, and inclusion. And but we need to move it past just it's a nice term, right? Because what's happened oftentimes, people have used the term diversity, in my view, as a diversion away from African-American. So when you can use the word diversity and you can say, well, let's throw in women, let's throw in Asian, let's throw in those who served in the armed forces, let's throw in any number of different things, you know, LGBTQ community, and then we wrap it all up in the word of diversity, it moves, it becomes a diversion away from what is the biggest problem, I think, in this country, which is a black and white issue. So would love to get your point of view on A, what does global diversity look like? And then more specifically in the U.S., and I know this is a handful of a question I'm asking you, but, you know, diversity, equity, and inclusion, define it, explain it. What is it you all are doing here in the U.S. and then on a global basis for diversity as a whole?
Yeah, I think that's a great question. And let me start by saying that I think you're absolutely right in describing this issue as a pandemic. I think you're spot on the money with that description. And I think 2020, for many reasons, will be seen as the pandemic of COVID. But I think what is perhaps becoming more appreciated now is that it's a pandemic of perhaps an even greater disease, and that is of systemic inequality and overt racism. And I think there was, you know, this was a year where we saw a spotlight being shone on this issue, maybe in a way that we hadn't seen it before. And I think your second point, that whilst diversity more generally is absolutely front and center and critical, I think often the broader definition of diversity allows for it to be something that you can hold less accountability against, because there are so many aspects to it, and it's easy to therefore say, oh, well, it's so hard, and you know, how do I hold myself accountable when I've got all these different aspects? So I think you're right. In some ways and in some different forums, it can be used to reduce an accountability against an issue that needs to be dealt with. As a global organization, as I mentioned earlier, operating across many different parts of the world, we see that this is an issue that needs to be dealt with, and that we have to really embark on a journey of change. And I think the issue of diversity, equity, and inclusion is very different in each of the different geographies that we operate in. But there is certainly a lot of similarities. And I think when we think about our US business and our important role in society in the US, I think 2020 was a year where we saw, you know, an incredible, rallying behind some real huge challenging issues. You know, we saw the George Floyd incident, the Breonna Taylor incident, which were outrageous. And I think that really brought to the fore these issues that perhaps were being swept under the carpet, or perhaps that weren't being appreciated for the problem that they actually are. So I'm hopeful and I'm optimistic that there will be a lot of good that comes of this, and that I think there is going to be greater ownership, greater accountability. And I think every organization needs to go on that journey. And quite frankly, I think every leader needs to go on that personal journey of discovery and figuring out what that means for them and how they can actually play a more important role. As a company, you know, we have been very clear on the need to really elevate our game. And I think any journey begins with a more honest look at your starting position. And unless you have an honest look at your starting position, I don't think you're really starting from the right point. So for us, we've spent a lot of time looking in the mirror and really trying to understand how big an issue it is in society and even within our own company. And that's uncomfortable, but I think that's critical. And it's really important to have that common starting point before you even embark on the journey of the changes that you need to make. The second big part for us is this appreciation for the fact that we have to do a much, much better job of ensuring that Blacks and people of color are better represented in our leadership ranks, and that the representation in our leadership ranks mirrors more the representation that they have in society. So there's a huge appreciation for the need for that change to happen. At the same time, we also believe that there's a need for a lot of work culturally within our organization. And that, you know, one of the biggest enemies to the issue is, I guess it goes back to the conversation we had earlier, and that is that there is this inertia just to keep doing things the way they've always been done. And that sounds harmless in this space. It's always been like this, so why change? And that is, I think, again, the enemy of making forward progress on systemic inequality and racism. And I think you have to really begin by educating people and helping them become more aware of the biases that they have, and help put infrastructure in place so that your hiring practices, your promotion practices are more cognizant of those biases so that you can start breaking them and then making some positive progress forward. So I don't think there is a silver bullet solution. I do think that the journey must begin with a realization of your starting point and the issues that exist in a corporation, in society. And then I think there needs to be strict accountability to the progress that you're making as a company. And you've got to measure that progress and report on it. And I think, you know, unless you have that, it's going to be very hard to see change. And, you know, to the point that you've made many times before, what we can't have happen is that people revert back to what they were doing before when the spotlight maybe gets lifted or isn't as bright.
Yeah, I mean, I think, Roy, that the spotlight on this is going to remain high for a period of time, and I'd like to think for a long period of time, but it has to start. You know, I talk to a lot of folks like yourself who are in CEOs and positions in corporate America, and what I implore upon them is that it has to start, it has to be from the top down, right? You can't assign this to a diversity officer and say, hey, go in there and do the best you can. Right, you got to lead by example. You've got to be at the forefront of it and say, no, this is, I really mean for this to be, this is going to take place and this is going to happen, right? And I'm going to, what gets measured gets done, as you said, right? So you've got to start first. Let's see where we are. Let's be honest about where we are. Let's look at some of the implicit biases that we may have, or things that we may have done that may have been painful along the way, what have you. But at least if we can have an honest look at it, and then we say, okay, now, where do we stand in? And I think that these are things that you know, Manulife and John Hancock in particular, since it's the US brought of it, what percentage of our officers, senior officers look like me, right? That are African-American, unapologetically. What percentage of our employee base? How does our board of directors stack up, whether or not it's the board of directors in the region or it's the corporate board of directors? How does that look? And where are we spending our money to attract African-Americans as customers? Because at the end of the day, what you really want is a seamless integration where you not only are getting people to become employees and want to work there, who want to stay there and become senior officers, but you also obviously want them as customers, because that's how, you know, you want assets under management. You want people to look at you as a way for financial planning and all the above. And I think where corporate America misses is that they don't seamlessly integrate all of that. They're kind of half pregnant with, I want the customers, but I don't really want to invest the money to try to attract the customers. Or I do have the customers, but I'm not sure I necessarily want my, you know, my C-suite to look. And so at the end of the day, you've got to ask yourself, if African-Americans in this country represent 14% of the population base, are we at that level across all layers of our organization? And are we spending that kind of money to get, is 14% of our business right now with people of color? And if not, why, right? And so this is not a kind of, you know, this is not a critique of Manulife in particular. It's just corporate America as a whole. And I think, you know, the fact that you, A, that you're leading the council is good. I know you have had a personal commitment to this. And I'd love for you to I know that this there was an incident that took place with, you know, a couple of years ago, where I think there was a lot that was learned from the organization from the top down. I'd love to give you the opportunity to discuss it and talk about it. And then what have you learned from that? And then and so that you are now putting things in place where everyone can feel safe, everyone can feel protected, everyone can feel as if they have an opportunity to advance.
Yeah. So I think you're absolutely right. I think it's a journey that must be led from the top. And as you highlight, Butch, it can't just be through ticking the boxes and saying the right things at the relevant town halls or being part of the right councils and the right forums externally and internally. It has to go far beyond that. And again, I think it's a function of, it ultimately will be measured through how well ingrained this is in the culture of the organization. And the buck stops when the metrics reflect, as you highlighted, the statistics that we all need to strive for and that we, quite frankly, need to be held accountable to. You know, it's outrageous that you would think that we would have leadership in any organization that doesn't reflect the population more broadly. So I think you're absolutely right. And I personally agree that that leadership needs to begin from the top. And it's not just about the forums you're in. People are watching their leaders. They're watching to see what's important to them, you know, how they talk about different challenges and decisions that need to be made. And they will take the cue from that. So I think that accountability absolutely must be there. I think, you know, on the later point that you made, you know, I certainly have gone through a lot of learning personally. And it's been a learning of a lot of discovery. And I say that with a lot of humility. And, you know, I've come to the complete realization that, you know, given my background, I can't understand or haven't been able to understand the challenges and injustices that many have, certainly the Black community and the people of color community, have had to, you know, endure. So that is, I think, an important first step in the journey. And I think what's critical is that you have to really begin that learning journey from a period of wanting to understand. You can't just sort of sit back and say, oh, okay, I get it because I've read the right books and I've understood what the perspectives are. I think you have to do a lot of listening. And for me, you know, I've spent a lot of time, certainly in 2020, you know, reaching out and listening. We've got a very robust ERG network. And, you know, they're tremendous because they represent the broader population of people and society. But at the same time, they're a tremendous source of inspiration, but also education for me personally and quite frankly for our leadership. So I look at them to help educate me and to help us understand what are the issues that many are facing and how do we actually tackle them. And again, I would just say that, you know, I think, you know, a lot of folks, you know, quite frankly, me included, you know, had this perspective, which is if intent is good, then that's an excuse for, or that will allow a lot to be forgiven. And, you know, my personal journey of learning and discovery has certainly taught me that it's not just enough to have good intentions. You need to understand what actions or what your actions are potentially, how they're potentially impacting different people and how that's being received. So I do think that, you know, there is certainly a huge degree of determination and drive around making change, but I do think it needs to be led from the top to the point that you made earlier. And I think every individual needs to go on a discovery of learning. And I think it's not until you've actually done that, that you can actually be prepared for embracing the change that you need to make and then ultimately the change that the company needs to make.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of intentionality in corporate America, but what really matters is results, right? Yeah. And accountability. You know, people can tell me about all their intentions. We intend to hire 20% more African-Americans. We intend to, all the intentions mean nothing at the end of the day your business, if you were down 20% in sales, in contracts, in such, you would figure out a way to fix it, right? You would strategically figure it out, sit down with the appropriate people, say, we got to fix this and we got to get our sales back up to whatever. And then not until such time as people treat this area of diversity, equity, and inclusion in the same way you would tackle a business problem, will there be systemic change, real change. Not I intended to do something, just it's a little bit like how the NFL has struggled with the Rooney rule. They've intended to hire more Black coaches, intended to have more Black general managers, but without a mandate. And I believe it has to be a mandate. I sit on, you know, two different corporate boards, and one of them in particular, and I said, listen, you got to put it into the compensation of your senior officers. Their bonus compensation has to have a component that is contingent upon reaching certain diversity, equity, and inclusion goals. And if it's not, if there's not going to be a consequence for it, then I don't believe we'll ever really, I think we'll be talking about it, and we'll be talking about it for the next 20 years, and it'll be a nice conversation, but it really won't. And I will submit to you that, and I'll get off this soapbox, but I'll submit to you that diversity enriches your company. It doesn't take away from the company. It enriches your company. You have diversity of thought, diversity of strategy, diversity of broad ideas and what's important. And I think that those companies that do the best in this area going forward will find out that their results, their bottom line results, will be reflected in that.
Yeah. Let me, if I can, if you don't mind. Sure. I think you're right. And I do think the business case for diversity is incredibly solid. You know, great organizations are those that have diversity, not just for the sake of it or in terms of a scorecard, but because diversity allows for better decision-making. When you've got different perspectives on a problem or a challenge that you're facing, you end up making better decisions because you've considered all the different possible permutations that may eventuate. And I think that better decision-making is the cornerstone of why diversity is, really what's in the best interest. But you touched on something else that I think is really critical, and that is the importance of KPIs and scorecards. And, you know, you're right. Unless the scorecard as it relates to diversity is given the same prominence and importance as sales or financial results, it'll always be a poor second cousin in terms of the prioritization list. And I'm quite optimistic on that front, because what I think we've seen, certainly in the more recent times, is that each of the key stakeholders of an organization, whether it's customers, employees, shareholders, society, regulators, there is a greater desire to see progress here. So stakeholders of organizations are saying it's not enough for you to come up with a fancy brochure that says all the right things. We want you to see that you're putting your money where your mouth is and that you're actually translating that into results. And we're going to vote with our feet, whether that's employees saying we're not going to work there anymore, customers saying I'm going to do my business elsewhere, shareholders saying, well, I'm going to put my investment or my capital into another company that's doing a better job. So I am quite optimistic. I think we're seeing a groundswell of this idea around stakeholder capitalism that will drive a stronger degree of transparency. And ultimately, I think that will translate into decision-making, which hopefully will help us see much, much more progress on this agenda.
One of the things that I was reading about, which I would love to hear more about that you use as your sort of almost a tagline, but your thought process around business, and that is called what you call make decisions easier and lives better. Give us a little bit of background on what that means to you and what that means to Manulife and John Hancock. You know, because a lot of people come up with wonderful terms, but they don't really, you know, they put up their 10, you know, things that are important to them on the these are the things that our corporation embraces and thinks are very, very important, but they don't necessarily have a strategy on how to execute that. But this is a really interesting term and quote that you guys have put together, or perhaps it came from you directly. So we'd love to hear more about that, if you would.
Yeah, so I think it's absolutely critical for any organization to have a purpose, to have a reason why it exists. And effectively, this becomes your North Star. It should guide every decision that you make, every trade-off that you need to contemplate. And I think that the difference between an organization that embraces its mission or purpose and makes it something that people live and feel passionate about versus something that, as you say, becomes a nice poster on the wall that people look at but don't really resonate with, is that it has to be something that you really do passionately believe in and you really can rally your entire organization to. I think the second part of the equation is that you need to have a roadmap or a strategic game plan that helps you realize that vision or that mission. So when we embarked on, you know, our strategy 3 years ago, I got the leadership team together and we said, look, you know, we have to do a reset on this company. We've had a great history. We've operated for in the US more than 150 years, 130 years in Canada, 120 years in Asia. So we've had this long history in each of the different geographies that we operated in. And it's been an incredibly successful history. But we also knew that what got us here is not going to be what gets us to where we need to go. And again, I think great organizations are, you know, required to reimagine their business and how it can be and should be relevant to be successful in the future. So we used a pivot point 3 years ago to really stop and pause and acknowledge what's worked well, but also know where maybe we weren't working as well as we needed, and then to start to chart the course for the future. The first step of that journey was to really rally around a mission. And that's one where we put a lot of time and effort into. But to the point that you made, this can't be something that just sort of gets created in some corporate head office. So we put a lot of effort into actually crowdsourcing what people thought our mission should be. What is our why? Why do we exist? The other thing that we did crowdsource was also our values. So again, you see a lot of values on walls, but we said, no, we want our values to be really impactful and we want people to resonate with them. So we need to get them sourced from the people that work for us, the 35, 37,000 people that come to work each day and support the business that we have. So the starting point was this mission, and we landed on this idea of decisions made easier, lives made better. And that really resonated with our people. When you think about what we do, you know, we help insure people's lives. We help them manage their wealth for retirement so that they can live a comfortable life in retirement. We help them manage their wealth so that they can achieve savings to deliver on their goals in life, whether that's to buy a house, go on a holiday or whatnot from the wealth management side. And, you know, this was a really cathartic moment because it helped us appreciate, hey, we're not just a company that makes money. We do a lot of good. You know, we're important to society and we play a really critical role in making lives better for our customers. And that really had a bit of a groundswell movement within our company. And it was this real, you know, when they came up with a caption line, and this wasn't my doing, it was a lot of creative people in our organization that captured that, but then went out to our entire organization and said, hey, what do you think? Is this right? And people got really excited because everyone knew that this is what we did, but to capture it in a way that was simple and really resonated with folks. And it was really, you know, honing in on this idea that, hey, if you can make lives better and decisions easier for customers, that's a pretty powerful thing. If we could do that for every one of the 30 million customers that currently is a customer of ours, or the prospective customers, we're making a difference. And that's something that can motivate people. I do think people come to work and they need to be inspired. They don't come to work just for a paycheck. Getting paid fairly is really critical, and it's an important aspect of why people come to work. But equally important is that people need to come to work and feel that what they do is contributing to making a better world. And that mission that we sort of landed on really help people resonate with that. And you'll hear, I mean, the proud moment for me is when I'm in a meeting with a whole lot of different colleagues, different levels in the company, most junior people, very senior people. And if there's a trade-off being made around a decision, someone will say, yeah, but is that making that customer's life better? And people will pause and say, hang on a sec, maybe not. And then they'll reevaluate. Well, is that the right decision then? Do we need to rethink this? And for me, that is a source of pride for me, because that tells me that this is not just something that sits in a corporate, you know, boardroom in a nicely framed, you know, poster, but right. Rather it really is resonating and means a lot to our people.
Yeah, no, I love that. I love the purpose rather than just a corporate mission statement or a corporate values saying on a wall. And it, in many ways, it demystifies and humanizes your business, because, you know, insurance, people look at it like, do I really have to, you know, and they don't look at it as being a part of their life in a way like, well, I got to get it because I got to insure my car. I got to get it because I got to insure my life, but not because it's actually sewn into the fabric. And this demystifies it and makes it for your customer base to say, oh, you're really trying to make my life better. And that will resonate with people. I want to just, you know, as we try to wrap this up, I really wanted to go towards health and wellness, because that's a part of making lives better, right? Because if you can help people to live longer lives, right, you ultimately pay them out at some point, but if they can have longer lives and better lives, that's a part of it. Talk with us a little bit about what is Manulife Vitality and Manulife Move. They're both health and wellness initiatives. You know, one of the things that we have in this country, especially in many of the minority communities, you know, we call it a food desert, and there's a health desert, right? And that is the access to health care is not equal. The access to food is not equal. And that contributes to the pandemic and the other epidemics that we in fact see within within our own community. But speak a little bit about these two initiatives, the Vitality and Move that Manulife has undertaken, and how that contributes to your overall purpose of Manulife in terms of making lives better.
Yeah. So I think one of the things that every organization needs to do is to understand how their purpose fits with the customer, right? And more broadly in the society that they operate in. And I think that any organization that economically benefits when the customer is disadvantaged, or put differently, if there's not a strong alignment between the corporation winning and the customer winning, I think that is a recipe for disaster in the long run. I think you may in the short term, you know, profit, but I think in the long run, unless you have a strong alignment of interests with your customer, then I think your business model is quite frankly flawed. And for us, you know, thankfully there is a really strong alignment. You know, we want people to live longer lives. If you live a longer life, then actually the financial benefit to us is actually higher, because, you know, we're paying out less. Sure. So having consumers live longer and healthier is certainly in our interest, and it's obviously in the best interest of our clients. So we took the next step of beyond just appreciating that strong alignment, of understanding that, you know, we need to be proactive in helping people live longer lives. And how do we make wellness something that we can actively participate in? So for us, you know, when we launched Vitality in the US, this was really founded on this idea. And that is that if you as a customer are living a healthier life, if you're eating better, if you're doing things that allow you to be healthier, whether that's exercising, whether it's meditation, whether it's sleeping better, then you're a lower risk to us. You're actually less of a risk to us as an organization. So you should benefit from that, and we should reward you for it, because you're lower risk, and therefore there's you know, less financial pain for us. And you're obviously winning as a result of that as well. So Vitality was founded on that principle, that idea. And basically, you know, through devices that you can get with the program, be it an Amazon Halo or an Apple Watch, you know, you can track your activities. You can, in the app, log some of the things that you're doing that may be, you know, highly correlated to living a healthier life. And as a result, you will get benefits, whether it's premium discounts or other rewards. And the whole idea is to help you get more motivated to live a healthier life and to, you know, focus on your own well-being and the wellness of yourself, not just physically, but mentally as well. So we've got this program now that we call Behavioral Insurance that operates across all of our geographies in the US, in Canada, and in Asia. We've got more than 2 million customers that have signed up to this program. And again, the most rewarding thing for us is when we get an email from someone saying, hey, listen, I lost, you know, 20 pounds because I've started following this program. And by the way, it saved me a whole lot of money through my insurance premiums in the process of doing that. So, you know, I think you're right. Purpose is critical. For us, alignment around this idea of making decisions easier and lives better for our customers is really a rallying cry. It's a North Star that guides every decision that we make. And vitality in the US in particular is the perfect beacon of how we're trying to make that come to life and how we're proactively really trying to partner with customers so that they can, you know, live the best life that they can and be as well as they possibly can. And quite frankly, in a year like 2020, that was probably more important than at any other time, not just physically, but mentally. The stress that folks have been under is immense. And having people focus in on what's going to keep them, you know, mentally sane and obviously physically well is going to be something that's very important for us as we look to the future as well.
Outstanding. Lastly, would love to get your perspective on, you know, we've had a bit of a circus situation here in the U.S. in regards to politics and how that has played out, and it's impacted a number of different things. It's impacted both of the pandemics that we spoke about earlier. But the, you know, what's the importance of politics between the US and Canada? And, you know, you operate in two different, you know, you're obviously, you know, your headquarters are in Canada, huge portion of your business is in the US. And there has to be, it would seem to me, there has to be some civility. What is your hope? I mean, you have civility. You may have disagreements in politics in Canada, but you don't have the kind of outsized circus type, you know, environment that we've had in the U.S. perhaps over the past 4 years in particular. And this is not me coming down one way or the other in regards to Republican, Democrat, what have you. It's just the civility of politics has gone out the window. Young people today have no interest in even pursuing going into politics, just looking at what is taking place. How do you see that impacting upon your business, the business model, and what role can business play towards trying to bring some civility back to how people interact with each other as well as politicians interact with each other?
Yeah, well, I think you're right. I think civility and tolerance are often missing in the dialogue as it relates to politics, unfortunately. And I think, you know, we've become so polarized. And I would argue that it's not just in the US, to be perfectly frank. I think in many different countries around the world, we've seen this polarization that's occurred, which has, I think, reduced the tolerance that people have to listen to alternate perspectives. And I think that is a great shame. I think what's critical is that we can respect that other people might have a different point of view, but that we should be willing to at least hear their point of view and have a civil debate and discussion over whether there's a different answer or a different perspective on that. So I think, you know, obviously the tensions of 2020 maybe exaggerated those issues and reinforced them. I think, again, when you've got this cauldron of the challenges that we saw in 2020, I think, again, the spotlight was very bright on a whole lot of different issues. You and I spoke about some of those earlier. But I do think that for us as a society to improve, I think we do need to embrace the civility of a discussion and one where people can present different viewpoints and even agree to disagree with a view to acknowledging that maybe, you know, their views might change or might alter in the future. So I'm quite optimistic. I think that, you know, I think that there is, you know, a greater appreciation for the importance of a dialogue of, you know, people engaging. I think, you know, what you said earlier is also very important. I think it's a great shame that we're not seeing more young people want to go into politics. I think we're going to, you know, I think we'll be significantly worse off if younger folks don't see this as a place where they can, you know, see a career and make an impact, because, you know, it's one of the greatest public services that you can actually perform is to be a public servant in a political arena. So I think you're right. I think we have seen, you know, a challenging time and a polarization. I think that's a function of you know, different parts of society perhaps feeling like they might be neglected. And I think it's important that, you know, we look for more of the common in us and look for the good in others more, rather than look for the differences and the negatives. So I think that's maybe something that we all have to play a role in trying to help facilitate. It's not just those at the fringes that need to come maybe a little bit more towards a median point. I think all of us have a role to play to bring people closer as well.
No doubt, no doubt. Well, Roy, I truly appreciate you taking the time to speak with me today. I greatly respect your commitment to diversity, equity, and inclusion. We need more leaders like yourself who are focused against this, committed to it, but genuine. You know, that you genuinely feel it. I speak with enough folks that I know are not genuine to be able to point out those that are. And so I truly appreciate you being candid and you genuinely feeling impacted by what's the need for us to come together as a society at large and to find a way to work with one another and to enrich each other's lives by embracing diversity and embracing the different thoughts and leadership necessary for us to be moving forward. So congratulations to all your success. I wish you much more success going forward with Manulife. We're privileged to be working with you all and look forward to continuing conversations with you going forward. So thank you very much for joining us.
Butch, it's been an absolute pleasure. It's always great to have a chance to have a chat with you, and thank you for the leadership that you're providing. I think it's not lost on anyone how important your leadership role is in helping us all not only get educated but advance this really important agenda. And you do, and your organization does some wonderful work, and we're absolutely delighted to be working with you. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.